What are you thankful for? Was that?
Family.
Thank you, Margaret. Family. What are you thankful for?
Health.
Health. Balcony. We're going to go up there too, so get ready for an answer. Somebody else down here.
Freedom.
Freedom. Wonderful. How many people are enjoying freedom in our nation? Come on, compared to most of the world. Woo. What else are you thankful for?
Friends.
That's what you said? Thank you. Somebody in the middle said something? Or is it the balcony? Grandchildren. Anybody thankful? A little bit? Some of you thankful for your grandkids? You know what's amazing about grandkids? You get to send them back to the parents after the visit, which is great, yeah. What else are you thankful for?
Great-grandchildren.
Anybody got great-great-grandchildren? Okay, we'll stop there then. Great-grandchildren, that's amazing. What else are you thankful for? This side, you guys are really quiet. What's wrong? Peace of mind, absolutely. It's a good thing to be thankful for. Oh, thanks, honey. I'm not going to repeat that because that embarrassed me. Anybody else, what are you thankful for?
Future hope.
Future hope, absolutely. Well, this morning, as we're looking at Thanksgiving, we also want to include joy. Thanksgiving and joy, that's the title for today's message. And if you're going to write notes, there might be a few scriptures you want to jot down as we go through, because I think that this is a message, although we're preaching it on Thanksgiving Sunday, to be honest with you, every Sunday needs to be Thanksgiving Sunday. And I think that we need to have Thanksgiving celebrations more than once a year. How many people know there's got to be more holidays for turkey? Come on, we need to create more, you know, holidays. Like, come on, a couple times a year is not enough for the turkey. And normally I bring up a bottle of water, but today I thought I'd bring up a beautiful Honey Crisp from St. Jacob's Market. How many people grateful for St. Jacob's Market? Like, that's, yeah, it's like this time of year. Yeah. All right. Now, let me tell you a couple of fun things first before we go here. How come the turkey did not eat dinner? Because it was already stuffed. Okay, that didn't work. What do you call a turkey the day after Thanksgiving? Lucky. I guess. I think I'll stop there because I got a chuckle and I'm looking at the rest of them. I think I won't get any better than that one. So we'll pause right there. Happy Thanksgiving, everyone. Sincerely mean that. And I pray that you have many reasons to give God thanks. If we pause long enough and we take time in prayer and we ask, Lord, what am I thankful for? I'll guarantee he will tell you. He'll begin to share with you some of the blessings that are in your life that maybe we take for granted, but he'll begin to reveal them to you. On this holiday weekend built around gratitude, we can learn a lot from the Apostle Paul. And we're going to look at a few scriptures in the New Testament today. Paul, a man who loved to celebrate God's grace in others with heartfelt thanks. Let me give you a scripture here that I believe is great. So let me throw up a quote by Jefferson Bethke, and he's a writer, young man, wrote an amazing book about Jesus is greater than religion. It's an amazing book. If you've never read it before, it's beautiful. But this is what he says, thankfulness is the quickest path to joy. This sermon is a path to joy. And so it's gonna be wrapped around all these ideas of thankfulness leading us to the path of joy. Everybody say joy. All right. Colossians chapter 3, verse 15, Apostle Paul writes these two words in the midst of many, but these two words stand out, and it says, always be thankful. Can you read that scripture with me? Always be thankful. How many people think that's really hard to always be thankful? How many people have reasons not to be thankful sometimes? Any grumblers and complainers occasionally? Something's not always right. And how many people are like, yeah, thankful? Really? How many people want to cut you off in traffic? You're not really thankful. How many people know you hit your nail, not the nail, but your nail when you're hammering? How many people know there's lots of reasons that might come out of your mouth that are not thanks, right? There's lots of reasons why we might not always, but Paul said, always be thankful. So this is a high calling, a big challenge. And it's a recurring exhortation in all of Paul's writings. In fact, the Apostle Paul, like no other New Testament writer, gives such a sustained emphasis on thanksgiving over and over and over again. All of his letters begin and end with thanksgiving. And yet, often studies of Paul omit this very area on his great emphasis on thanksgiving. For whatever reason, his sustained thanksgiving is not necessarily wrestled with theologically as much as I think it should be. Personally, I think it should be. For Paul, thanksgiving is grounded in the covenantal traditions of salvation history, of all the things and reasons why we are to be thankful. And Paul says, to offer thanks to God is to live a life of joy. He also says, to anticipate the future acts of God is to create in our hearts an attitude of not just worshipful obedience to God for the lordship of Jesus Christ in our lives, but also a heart of gratitude for the things that God has not yet done for us. See, the highest form of faith in my mind is praising God before you get your answer. The highest form of praise is thanking God before you see any changes in your prayer requests. How many people know thanks is a holy thing, is a powerful thing? It's a sign of faith in your life that will lead to joy. Paul infers that ingratitude to God is idolatry. It's pretty serious. Paul says, learning to speak thanks is what cleans up the mouth. Now, I'm not talking about crude language or vulgar use of the tongue. I'm not talking about that kind of cleaning up the mouth. Although, mind you, it's not a bad idea to clean up the mouth if that's the situation. But thanksgiving has a powerful effect, a cleansing effect on our lives. So when Paul's modeling a life of gratitude, these are the things that he uncovers for us. When he means by cleaning up our mouth, he's basically saying, he infers that complaining comes out of the mouth, gossiping, hello, comes out of the mouth, mocking, backbiting, murmuring is a form of idolatry. How many people know the people of Israel, when they were running around the mountain a whole bunch of times, round and round and round and round, and they didn't get into the promised land? Why? Because they were so bad? Because they were murderers? No, they weren't murderers, they were murmurers. Because of their murmuring, they another time around the mountain. God wanted to refine the people of Israel so that they would always be a people of praise. We'd always hit it, but that's the goal. Here's interesting about Paul, and then I'll get into some ideas for us to consider, is he mentions thanks 50 times in his epistles. Epistles are the letters they wrote to the church. 50 times, the Apostle Paul mentions the subject of thanksgiving more frequently, listen to this, more than any other ancient author, pagan or Christian, nobody talks about thanksgiving more than Paul. Isn't that amazing? Of all the ancient books, gratitude is Paul's forte. This is what he understands. Why? Because Paul knew what it meant to come to have an encounter with the living Christ and his life to be changed. How many people know Paul went from a murderer to a believer? And in that way, he became very grateful, knowing he was the chief of sinners, and now his sins were forgiven. Come on, church. Isn't that a reason right there to give him praise alone? So here is a high claim, and I'll read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 as an example for you what Paul would write. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 13 to 14. I was thirsty. I got your attention now. Verse 13. But we ought to always give thanks to God our Father for you, brothers and sisters, beloved by the Lord. Why? Let's pause there for a second. Why? Well, it answers it right there. There's the because coming, right? So you as the beloved of the Lord, I always give thanks for you, my brothers and sisters. Why? Because God chose you as the first fruits to be saved through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. Because of your engagement with the word of the Lord, allowing the Spirit of God to transform, to sanctify, to change your life. And because you believed the truth, you believed in Jesus. So he gave God thanks for his brothers and sisters. And then to this he called you through our gospel so that you may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't that a great scripture? Absolutely beautiful. So thanksgiving functions as a bridge between what we believe and how we practice our faith. Thanksgiving is something that holds those things together, because it's not just something that goes on inside of our heart, but it's now that something that we live out in our lives. We live it amongst our family. I'll say it this way. Show me a joyful person and I'll show you a grateful person. I think gratitude impacts our emotions. How many people would agree? When you're happy and praising God about something, does that not affect your soul? Turn the person beside you and smile at them because they need it right now. Go ahead. Yeah. Show me a joyful person, I'll show you a grateful person. So my assignment today in these next few minutes, albeit brief, is to simultaneously educate you, to edify you, but to reveal how the effect of thanksgiving and joy points to the way ahead for all of us. You can be living in dire times. You can be living in times of inflation or recession. All of those things are all temporal, and they're all in the world, and they don't have to affect the joy of the Lord that is your strength. Let me throw this on the screen. Gratitude is the entrance into worship. We read it from Psalm 100 this morning. Enter his gates with what? Thanksgiving. And into his courts with praise. This is how we enter into worship. See, worship is when your heart connects with God's heart, where you are literally giving him, adoring, you're declaring his holiness, you're declaring his worth. That is worship. But how many people know you can't just go from 0 to 100 in a second? Sometimes you need an on-ramp to get onto the highway of worship. And so praise and thanksgiving is that ramp. So you're there, oh, thanks. I'll enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. Sometimes it's just words that you say to get your heart ready to engage with worship. So praise, thanksgiving is the on-ramp to worship. I'll be honest with you. Gratitude is the entrance into worship. And I'll follow this. And if you experience it as a burden, if you experience gratitude as something that you have to do as a duty, if you experience it as a burden and not a joy, you haven't truly experienced it yet. Now, that's a kind of a strong statement to make, saying that you're not very grateful if it's a burden. It might start off natural. I know, I'll tell you a story real quick. Pastor Paul Follett was a young adults pastor at Evangel Temple, and he was really hurting. His whole back was hurting. His legs were hurting. He injured himself over some doing some work. And the reality was he was sitting on the front row and God told him to dance his healing in. Isn't that a weird thing to say? Dance his healing in. I mean, it wasn't like he didn't have like leukemia or he didn't have, you know, diabetes. I'm talking about his body was sore. Anybody, sometimes your bodies get sore and you overcome, right? You get through it. But he was standing there and he'd been suffering with pain. He wasn't a young man anymore. That's probably the issue. Probably playing sports. Anybody, you think, I remember last time skateboarding, I broke two ribs. My two boys said, "Dad, you're too old." That was it. That's all I needed. I fell, broke two ribs. How many people know sometimes you hang up your hat, your skateboarding hat, whatever it is, and you know, that's not for me anymore. Anybody have that experience? Yeah, a few of us. So Paul's there, very sore. He couldn't even stand. And God said, dance in the healing. And they're singing, "Give thanks with a grateful heart." Give, like a mellow, quiet, not a lively song. And God said, "Now." And so here's all of us, just quiet worship. And Paul's dancing like a madman, like a fool. Like I'm looking at him and goes, something gone wrong with Pastor Paul. He's like lost it. He's dancing like a maniac on the front row, whatever's going, "Give thanks." And he was healed. He didn't feel like it, but he responded. He told his body to praise in the midst of his pain. And God was gracious to him and merciful to him. And he didn't do it out of a duty. He responded of giving praise and worship to God. How many people are glad God's never asked you to act like a fool before? I can't put up my hand on that. Now let's talk about the joy effect a little bit here. Joy builds on, here's three things that are going to happen. Joy builds when we reflect on the past. We'll talk about that. When we reach for the future and we remain certain in the present. So that's what the joy effect does. So Thanksgiving begins with a choice to reframe our perspective. To choose to be a person of Thanksgiving is something that you have to make that decision. You say, I don't feel like being grateful. I don't want to give thanks. I'm not in mood. But it's the choice to reframe your perspective, to find reasons why it might be a good idea to give God thanks. How many people know happiness is based on happenings? Good happenings, happiness kind of shows up. Bad happenings, and you're not feeling that happy. Joy and happy are not the same thing. Happy is circumstantial, based on your circumstances, based on your happenings. Joy is a spirit. In fact, the fruit of the Spirit is love, and the first way it's demonstrated in Galatians is joy. It's the top of the list. It's an important quality. So joy is an evidence of the Spirit's work in your life. So happiness is happenings, joy is spirit. And Thanksgiving is a deep-rooted belief that despite our situation, we can choose our perspective. This is tough for me sometimes because I just don't always feel like having a good perspective on things. As followers of Jesus, there are a few things that impact us more than actually a fresh perspective on things. Let me throw this on the screen as well. Remembrance leads to gratitude. Gratitude leads to joy, and joy leads to strength. So further along this path of joy, this is what happens. So remembrance, how many people could take a moment right now, just pause and just remember one good thing that happened to you this week. One good thing, just one good thing. Anything? Well, what would that be? Would that be enough to give you a heart of gratitude? These are really good. What's one thing that you remember that you're grateful for that happened this week? Fellowship with food. The emphasis with food. That's good. Anybody else? Something this week that happened that actually you're grateful for? You did not expect a sermon where you had to participate, right? The fall colors. The fall colors. Isn't that spectacular? You look back and wow, it's amazing. The reason why I'm asking this is because sometimes we don't engage with the idea of remembering. We just go through life many times because we're so busy and we're not paying attention to the very things that are surrounding us or that we're experiencing. But if we remember well, we'll look at, that was an amazing experience. Such a great conversation I had with somebody this week. I said, wow. I really enjoyed that conversation. I remember when I visited Nodane at her seniors' care home. I never laughed so hard in my life. I remembered it fondly. When I did her funeral, I felt like laughing because I loved that lady so much. And I only met her once. My remembrance of her led to gratitude. I think that's something we can all grow in. Would you agree with me? So let's talk about these three things. Number one, reflect. Gratitude is the seed of joy. Again, you're planting gratitude, you're sowing gratitude with the hopes of that seed developing and growing in your life. It might happen quickly, it might happen over a long period of time, but gratitude is the seed of joy. In our era of anger, anxiety, and anguish, Thanksgiving has never been more needed. Gratitude is absolutely vital. So do not despise small beginnings. Do not despise the small little moments where you actually like seed, sowing seed of gratitude, so reflecting what God is doing. Sowing gratefulness is a holy and worthy mission. All of us should daily remind ourselves that it's important to reflect in spending time with God, that I'm going to actually be grateful. Remember, the harvest will not be overnight. Deep inside this beautiful Honeycrisp apple are seeds. If I planted these seeds in my garden, which I don't have, which I should have, in my garden, how many people know next week there won't be a tree blossoming beautiful apples? Seed takes time. Gratitude, to spring it to joy, sometimes takes time. God's not into speed, he's into seed. Remembering this, continuing sowing seed. So look what God's already done for you. What are the things that he's taken you through? What has he healed you from? What has he set you free from? What are the things that God has done in your life that you can give him praise for? Gratitude is the seed of joy. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus was very clear in Matthew chapter 5. This is Jesus' longest message. He preached a full sermon here. And if you read the whole thing, Jesus' longest sermon was about 20 minutes. And everybody go, wow, why don't you follow that, Pastor? Be more like Jesus. Because I'm not Jesus and I need way more time to say what I need to say. Jesus was perfect. His sermons were perfect. So get off my back, all right? Matthew chapter 6, so just read a couple of verses, 31 and 32. It says, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. Let me just pause there. If you ask me, what is the perfect description of the term God's providence? It's found in this idea here. God already knows what you need. He's already aware of the great need for every area of your life. He knows what will bring a blessing in your life. He knows what will help you. He knows how to comfort you. He's got all the answers ready for your engagement. So we don't need to be anxious. We don't need to worry. And instead of being anxious and worrying, we need to, by faith, begin to sow seeds of gratitude, which will eventually come. And that's what providence is all about. God has got you. The God of the Bible, and found in the word providence, the English root word of the word providence is to provide for you, to be there for you in every way. To provide comes from a combination of two Latin words, pro. So if you look at providence, so providence, but it's pro, which means ahead. God sees ahead. And the Latin verb videre, which means to see. So God sees ahead before you even see you have a need. To provide literally means to look ahead, to prepare, to supply, to act with foresight. I'm just reading from the Bible dictionary here. And that is the word providence. So Christians have traditionally understood the word providence. It's been twisted in the last little while, and some theology has made all about providence being, you know, it's all up to God about everything. God does this. God saves who he wants to save, and the rest are going to hell. In fact, I heard one preacher say, God saves those he wants, and the rest are kindling for hell. Can you imagine that insanity? That's from a famous preacher. That's like that, what? Because they believe in a warped concept of providence, that God is going to provide what he needs, and everything else doesn't really matter. How many people believe that would be heresy or crazy? One of the two. That kind of idea. That's not what providence is. Providence is about the provider, God himself, making a way for you to make it in this life. I love that about our God. He cares so deeply. And the traditional doctrine of providence of God, tells us that God knows what we need even before we tell him, and that God has every intention of providing for those needs even before we ask him. That blows my mind. Why do we pray then? What's the purpose of praying? So we come in agreement with what he wants for us. We come into alignment. So the answer that he has for us actually shows up in our lives because we're ready to have his will be done for us. Isn't that good news? Now, I believe that this is generally true in the sense that God has a certain structure for our lives. He has a way that he wants our lives to live. And he sustains us and he's designed a way for him to sustain us in all of these things. Our physical well-being, our emotional well-being. I believe that God is particularly true in the way that God pays special attention to his kids. He loves his children, the ones who have specific care, receive specific care, for those who belong to him by faith. God has favorites. You say, there's no God, no respecter of person. That's not what I'm saying. God likes his kids. Do you like your kids? Well, don't put up your hand if they're here. If you don't, that would not be a good idea. God loves his kids. He likes his kids, and he listens to his kids and pays special attention to his children. And I believe Romans chapter 8, verse 28 famously says, we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, his kids, and to them who are called according to his purpose, his kids. See, God's working all these things for our good. Isn't that good news? No matter what you're going through, if you're going through hell, don't stop. If you're going through a difficult time, just know that God is working all things for good. This presupposes that some things are not good, that he's going to make things good. You ever heard a theologian, John Stott, before? He's British, but he kind of adopted Canada as a home. And he talks about the biblical doctrine of providence. This is amazing. I love this idea. He says, providence is the pillow in which the head of faith rests. Isn't that amazing? Kind of illustration. I love that idea. What he meant by that is no matter what might happen to us, we as Christians can trust that God will hold us. He will keep us. And he's not letting us go. Isn't that good news? So when we reflect all those things, that's the seed. Gratitude is the seed for joy. Second thing I want to talk about is reach. This is actually really important. We talked earlier. When we reflect, we're looking to the past. When we talk about reach, we're talking about looking in the future. Expectation for the future creates joy in the present. Now, my daughter's really bad with this. If she's got a birthday present or a Christmas present, she wants to know what's in it all the time. She will ask, I'm not so sure she keeps, well, she's 19 now, and I don't think much has changed since she was little, but we have to hide anything in the house. We literally have to hide it. In fact, Christmas Eve, there's not even a box under the tree for her because she'll tear into it. She just can't wait. How many people know expectation for future creates joy in the present? Sometimes there are so many gifts and things that God has for us that we're like little kids, we can't wait. And there's a joy and anticipation of what God has for us. The dictionary defines expectation this way, as an anticipation for something to be revealed. It's a beautiful thing. The key to expectation begins with managing frustration, which is the hindrance to joy. Frustration. You have to be able to learn how to manage your... How many people know life has lots of frustrations? In fact, it's built into how it works. I'm not sure why, but frustration is just part of the deal. Frustration is everywhere, and you have to learn how to manage your frustrations. Philippians chapter 1, verse 20 speaks to this. According to my earnest expectation and hope, talking about future hope, right? And expectation creates joy in the present. According to my earnest expectation and hope, Paul's writing, that I will in no way be disappointed. It means frustrated. So Paul's been frustrated before. How many of you have never been frustrated? Okay, good. Frustration is there all the time. I will no be frustrated, but with all boldness, as always, now also Christ will be magnified, listen to this, in my body, whether by life or by death. It doesn't matter what happens to me. If I live through this or if I die, I have great expectation that God's got me and everything's going to be okay. And somebody said to me on Facebook, they sent me a quote. Well, I'm not so sure that's true. What if some people are believing and God doesn't, and they die before they get their answer? And I went, that's the whole point. We go to heaven. Like, that's the ultimate goal. Man, they are the ones who got, you know, graduated into glory. That's the best prize ever. How many people, you get over a sickness and you're like, you're over it, and then you're like, you got to still die later. I mean, that's not always, you're not looking forward to that. It's like somebody's going through a hard time and then they go to heaven. How many people know they got the best reward ever? Yeah, and we're still here. That's the reality. It doesn't really matter. Paul says, whether by life or by death, I have an eager anticipation. Frustration doesn't go away though. The question is, how do you manage it? Can you resolve it? Maybe. Can you fight through it sometimes? I'm talking about your frustrations. Can you see it differently? That's hard to do, but that's necessary sometimes. Can it motivate you? Sometimes I'm so frustrated and agitated, it motivates me to change something in my life. And can it be a reminder that because you're frustrated, it's an indication that you're believing God for something. You're trusting God for something, for him to show up in your tomorrows, expecting that God, listen to this, that God will do for you what is true of you. Beautiful. The only thing that's more important than who you are today is who you are becoming tomorrow. We're all changing. So the expectation of the future is about getting our hearts ready, getting ready for all that God has for us. If you're not careful, let me just say this, if you're not careful, you can start to think that your biggest obstacle is where you are. Let me speak to some young people for a second. Some of the biggest frustration of being a teenager and in your 20s and you're studying and you're doing all these things and you're not sure exactly the direction for your life is you're frustrated with where you are now. Remember, God's not done with you yet. Your future is still in front of you and you have much to look forward to as God leads you in the paths that he has for you. So the biggest challenge is not where you are, is knowing where you're going and then point in that direction. So we fix our eyes on Jesus, who's in our future ready. All right, what happens to me sometimes is I believe that, but instead what happens is these gaps between what I believe and where I am to where I need to be. Anybody have a character issue in your life that you're working on? I'm in mentoring, and so once in a while, my mentor in the class that we're in Church Renewal, they'll ask us, so what character issue is in your life right now that God's working on? And sometimes that changes. Mine, not always. I won't tell you today. I've given you hints before, but I don't have time to talk about it because I don't have to explain it, and that's going to take way too long. But how many people have ever had character issues that God has put his finger on, say, there's a gap between where you are to where you need to be? Anybody want to be honest with me? Thank you, Pastor Kyle. And Amy, too. Thank you. Nobody else? Okay, there's a few other people here. It's a work in progress. It's where God is calling us to, but we're not there yet. Don't be frustrated with where you are. Just know that God's leading you forward. So don't let those gaps depress you. Let those gaps cause you to be grateful that you're going somewhere. Third thing, and I'll close with this thought, is so we reflect on the past, right? So we reach towards, with expectation towards tomorrow. All of this is about gratitude. And the third one is we remain when joy is a habit, love becomes a reflex. I'll explain that a little bit. When joy is a habit. So in our present, where God is working on us, who we are becoming is really important, but we're not there yet. But let me tell you, let me help you how to get there. So we can only fix the present. You can't fix tomorrow. It hasn't even arrived. Tomorrow's got enough worries of its own, Jesus says. And how people know you can actually not fix the past. How many have tried to fix the past before? It doesn't always work. Sometimes forgiveness releases you from the past. So that kind of fixes some things. Forgiveness is so important. I think forgiveness is I'm actually not a bad forgiver. I can forgive. Now, what's happening in my older age is that I can learn to forgive and forget because I'm forgiven, then I forget. Like sometimes I'm just a good forgetter and I'm not sure I'm that good of a forgiver. And so I'm able to let go of things quite easily because I forgot that happened. My wife knows, she's laughing at me like, yes, honey. I'm on all kinds of supplements to work on that. So I'm going to be okay. Don't give me your essential oils because I don't believe in that. Aromatherapy. Oh, no, I don't need that. Okay, so don't sell me anything. But I know that forgiveness is the key, not just to forgiving to be released from my past, but in my present to have joy. For God to work in my heart, I need to be a forgiving person. So here's some help. Habits form whether we like it or not. Whatever you repeat, you reinforce. Rather than become someone or something by accident, why not become who you're called to be on purpose? So, we can't help but grow. This apple is one of the biggest apples I've ever had. I'm 2 bites in and I'm already full. I'm still thirsty, so I might have another bite in a moment. But the reality is, how many people know that was actually not around a while ago? Like last spring, it was just an imagination of a tree, an apple tree, that one day I'll have little apples or big apples. And the tree's there standing in the blossoms and the bees come and they pollinate the blossoms and then the seed, the bud grows and then there's the apple. How many people love apples? Anyone want a bite of my apple? No? Okay. So. Here's what's amazing to me. This didn't exist last year. 6 months ago, it was like a little, small little. This is what gratefulness does. Something, the fruit of it didn't, might not have existed long ago, but now you're enjoying the fruit of gratefulness because you not just sowed seed, but you watered it, you allowed it, you tended it to grow, and it becomes something amazing. You know what's actually blowing me away? I drive down the highway, and they're harvesting corn right now. Have you seen how weird the corn is this year? Like the whole bottom half is like completely brown because they're so tall. You walk through the corn. How many people know corn was really tall this year? One little freaking kernel in the ground. Little, you know what a corn kernel is? You're having corn probably on your Thanksgiving dinner. Hold one of those corns up and give God thanks. The little corn kernels. It's like it was in the ground and it became with all those corns on it, corn cobs on it. Thousands of corns from one kernel that didn't exist last year. Is that not blowing? You're looking at me like I'm crazy? To me, okay, this gives me gratitude that God can take smallness and do something amazing with it. Some of you don't have joy in your life. God wants to blossom joy as big as this apple in your life, as tall as the corn is in your life, because it's built into nature. It's built into God's nature. It's built into how the Spirit works in our lives. Yet the growth curve, listen to me very carefully, can slope upward or slump downward, depending on how we cultivate those very small seeds in our lives, the small areas in our lives. Making progress in this area is possible. It's if you accompany the seeds of gratitude with prayer and asking God for more opportunity to grow. And I'll be honest with you, what we need to know is that the joy, the benefit of this in our life is absolutely amazingly good. So thankfulness, gratitude leads us to this place where joy shows up, and joy, I'll throw this up here, joy forgets the sorrows and remembers the good. Would you read that with me? Joy forgets the sorrows and remembers the good. That's what the gift of joy is. That doesn't make everything right, but joy then, the focus becomes no longer on the sorrow, but on the good. This is what's so great about the phrase, the joy of the Lord is my strength, because I said eventually gratitude leads to joy, joy leads to strength. And so Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 10 says, then he said to them, go your way, eat the fruit of the land, eat the fat, eat what's been produced, drink the sweet, and send portions to those for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy to our Lord. Hear this, do not sorrow, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. This phrase can provide comfort, it can provide courage, it can provide strength for us when things are hard to bear, but the joy of the Lord is your strength. Here's the reality, in these days and in your days, and in the last days, we're going to need more strength than we've ever had before. And it comes through sowing seeds of gratitude today that become joy, that become strength. What a gift gratitude is for us. How many people could be more grateful in your life? Let's be honest. We're in church. Tell the truth. Who could be more grateful? How many would want more joy in your life? And how many people know you'd be lost without the strength of God? I wanna pray a prayer by asking this question, specifically, honestly, who literally needs strength today? You don't have time to sow seeds of gratitude. You don't have time for joy to blossom in your life and become this amazing thing in your life. How many people need strength now, right now? Thank you. Anybody else? Specific strength in your life. I want you to join me in prayer. I see others who've lifted their hands. Honestly, today you need strength. We're going to pray specifically for you. All right. Anybody else? We're all going to pray together. Would you join your faith with mine as we pray for the individuals in this place that lifted their hand that need God's strength today? All right, let's join in prayer. Father, this morning, we are grateful for your word. We're thankful for the joy that comes through understanding our relationship with you. And Lord, there's enough in that relationship to give us the strength we need. But we also know, Father, that there are some people right now, they're depleted, they're defeated, they're burnt out, they're stressed, they're overwhelmed, they're so burdened. And our Thanksgiving prayer is right now that, Father, they would have the faith to be able to catch a tiny glimpse of this, a seed, so to speak, so that in their lives right now, you would manifest the promise of strength for these, my friends. God, you made them, you love them, and here they are honestly asking for strength. So my prayer today, Lord, is not that you would give them strength, but that you would be their strength. And we ask this in Jesus' glorious name. Amen and amen.
Familiar. Let's challenge ourselves to really sing them and really mean them and really understand the weight of these words. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? King above all kings.
worship the Lord. Give him thanks in your heart right now. Your own words, give him thanks. We praise you, Lord. Sing your worship to the Lord. Thank him for something in your life that God's been doing. Praise him for that good, whatever it may be. Just thank him right now for it. We give you praise. You are worthy, Lord. Worthy, 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 Lord. We thank you for all these blessings in our lives. We're a blessed people. He is worthy to receive our praise. He's so good to us. Right, Daniel? We all have stories of God's goodness. You have stories of God's goodness. Never forget how good he's been to you. Never forget how worthy he is of all that he's done to save you from sin, to give you salvation, to promise you heaven. Come on, church. It's crazy how good this all is. Don't get religious. Get all religious and, oh, yes, Lord, you're good. No. I'm talking about from the depths of your being. We got an amazing God. Grace is amazing. It's just absolutely mind-blowing how good our God is. He is worthy because he is absolutely amazing. Father, today, all your people in this house, we are grateful people. Teach us to be more grateful. Help us to be more thankful. But Lord, there's so many good things that we can praise you for. And we don't want to leave this place with thinking of at least one more thing that we're grateful for, telling you right now, thank you, Jesus. Go ahead, right now, one more thing that you're thankful for. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for my family. Thank you for my grandkids. Thank you for my daughter. Thank you for my wife. Thank you for this church. Thank you for all these beautiful people, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for everything you're doing. My. He is so good to us. Yeah, he's good. He's really good. Thank you, Lord. If you don't know Jesus, personally, if you've never accepted Christ into your life, say, Jesus, forgive me of the sin of my life. I need you. I want more than just heaven. I want a relationship with you. If that's you today and you want us to pray for you, we're going to do that right now. If anybody in this place, that's you, you're not sure you're going to heaven, you're not sure Christ is in your life and you'd like to come back to him in some way. Okay, thank you, Lord, for everyone that their hearts respond in this moment. Thank you that you are helping them understand how good you are by forgiving them of their sin, by saying, Jesus, come into my life, forgive me, and be my Savior and be my Lord. And for all of us in this place, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to recognize how good you are to us, how amazing your grace is. And we give you praise as we go into our day, as we go to our turkey dinners, as we go with family, with friends. Pray for those who are alone. Lord, anybody that's feeling lonely in this weekend, that you would comfort them with a supernatural comfort, that the nearness of God would be so, so close to them. And we thank you for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, praise the Lord. Pastor Kyle is going to be at the blue corner right back there. If you don't know, that's a place if you want to connect with us. But also we have Spark Magazine. It's a Gospel of John magazine. You could use it to evangelize. It's amazing for young adults. Teens, sure. Young adults, for sure. If you know of a young adult that you'd like to love them, you could pick up a Spark Magazine. We have a whole bunch. We can order more. And the formerly Gideon's Share Word Global is giving us these resources now. So you can use them just to be a kindness to somebody and show them the love of God. I mean, it's pretty amazing. Like, there's awesome photos in here and there's emojis and everything. So like, wow, just for the emojis alone, it would be great. God bless you as you serve him. Have a great week. Sonia and I will be in the lobby to say hello, but see Pastor Kyle if you want to pick up one of these. God bless. Have a great week.